coming on, coming on. Yeah.
The White Sox haven't entered a season as defending champs since 1918. Tonight, before they unwrap the new season, they'll put a bow on 2005, celebrating the thrilling postseason run and first World Series title in 88 years by hoisting the championship banner at U.S. Cellular Field, a ceremony we will carry live here on this very network.
I think it's fitting that 158 days after the champagne started flowing, it still feels a little bit like fall. Not too cool. Sun's peeking out a bit there on the south side, but there's a good chance we'll see rain at U.S. Cellular Field tonight. It certainly won't dampen the celebration as we put the final footnote on the 2005 World Champs and get set for a repeat run.
And we, of course, will keep our eye on the Doppler radar throughout the show and keep you updated on everything from the weather to, of course, the starting lineups for tonight's opener. Thanks for joining us for Land Rover Sports Night, everyone. With Pat Boyle, I'm Carrie Sayers.
We're with you for the next hour. We have team coverage on the south side to bring you all the flavor from tonight's pregame festivities, from the ceremonial first pitch to the World Championship banner being unveiled. Let's send it out now to Chuck Garfine, who's standing by with a man who, when we last had him live on our airwaves, I think he was puffing a celebratory stogie and had a certain trophy in his hand, Chuck.
Oh, he did have a trophy, and I am with the chairman of the board, Jerry Reinsdorf. And Jerry, you've had 6 months to call yourselves world champions. In your quieter moments, are you still saying to yourself, we did it, we did it?
Yes, I mean, you know, very often I'll be in a conversation with somebody, and I'll just say, I still can't believe it. I still can't believe it.
It wasn't, to me, what struck me was not the fact that you guys won the World Series, even though it had been so long, but how you won the World Series, losing only once in the postseason. You know, you couldn't give the ball to MJ and have him win the game. You had to have five different starters out there every night, and you guys did it.
You know, it was amazing, because remember, we went from a 15-game lead to a game and a half, and everybody was thinking that we were going to blow the whole thing. And then all of a sudden, we didn't lose again for the rest of the year, winning 17 of the last 18 games we played. So it was amazing how fast it happened. The games were very competitive, but it was just amazing how fast it happened.
But you can only look back so much. You now have to look forward. You had a lot of experience with repeating with the Bulls. How difficult is it to do it again?
It's extremely difficult to repeat, more so in baseball, I think, than in any other sport, because baseball is such a mental game, and the players can, you know, lose a mental edge. Basketball, football, you practice, and you pretty much get out of a player the same thing year in and year out. But you look at baseball, guys have good years, bad years, in between years, and so many things have to happen. They have to line up just right for you to win a World Series. But, you know, we're going to give it our shot.
Well, one guy who I'm curious about is Jim Thome. He's been playing great in the spring. How did Kenny Williams present him to you, saying, we got to get this guy?
Well, Kenny first came to me and told me he thought that he might be available because of the fact that, you know, they had the rookie of the year who took his place after he got hurt. And, you know, my first reaction to him was, well, we can't afford that salary, so you better go and see how much you can get Philadelphia to pay for it. And he did
pretty
good.
They're paying a little bit of it, huh?
They're paying a little bit of it, yeah.
But how does it feel to see him out there? He looks like he's on pace for that kind of 40 home run, 100 RBI season you guys are hoping for.
Yeah, you know, you can't tell by his spring, but it certainly does. He does look good. You know, he came here with a reputation of being a great guy, and everybody says that he's just a super individual. And if he's healthy, and he appears to be healthy, we should score more runs than we did last year.
Now, behind us, I don't think we can see it on camera, though, we have the banners that are about to be revealed later in this program, right before the game. What is that going to mean for you, the symbolism of it all?
Well, the meaning of winning the World Series really is the happiness that was brought to so many people in Chicago. It was just amazing, the impact that the World Series had on people. You go to any cemetery, find graves decorated White Sox memorabilia. I don't know how many emails and letters and I got from people talking about their parents and their grandparents, even from people who lost children but who managed to live long enough to see the World Series. It really was a very heartwarming thing.
It's more than just baseball.
There's no question about it. Baseball is America.
All right, Jerry, thank you very much. Really appreciate it. Good luck tonight, okay?
Thank you.
All right, we're going to send it now over to, you know, we talk about baseball. Will there be baseball? That's one of the topics of Mark Chenowski is going to be talking about over on the first base side. Mark?
All right, Chuck, thanks a lot. You know, I'm still working on my meteorology shield, so I can't give you any expert opinions here. But we did talk to the head groundskeeper, Roger Bossard. He was worried about a big shower coming in about 5 o'clock or so. Well, we've cleared that. It's a little past 6 now. No rain in sight right now. The skies look pretty bright and blue. Hopefully the weather will hold off and we'll get the ball game in tonight. A big ceremony, a sellout crowd. It should be a lot of fun here at U.S. Cellular Field. One thing that's working to the Sox advantage if they get the game started on time, it should be a fast game because Mark Burley is starting for the White Sox and he is the king of the two-hour ball games. Matter of fact, the Indians know that very well because Burley shut them out on opening day a year ago. Pitching for the Indians tonight, C.C. Sabathia, a hard-throwing left-hander, so it should be a good pitching matchup. We're looking forward to that as well. And as for the White Sox batting order, well, Scott Posednik will be at the top of the order. There was some concern would Scotty Pods be ready after he strained a groin muscle during the final week of spring training. Between the groin injury and a shoulder strain, Posednik did not get a lot of work during the spring. But he went out, took batting practice, took some outfield work, and he says even if it rains and the field's a little bit sloppy, he's going to be out there close to 100% doing what he can do. Here's what Scott had to say before the game.
I'm close to 100%, I feel. I think for the most part, it's just mentally getting over that hurdle, just trusting it, being able to go out and not and put it back in my mind and not worry about it. It's up to me to go out and really prepare myself to make sure I get good, loose, and hot before I'm out there.
Pod is a big part of my ball club. As long as healthy, he will be in the lineup. I think we need him over there, and I think the question was how we feel. I think Pod is kind of the kid is always worried about getting hurt. Or, you know, you got to play sore every day, but I think he's fine, and I just put it there right away just because I want him to help us the quick as we can. He was swinging the bat pretty good before he got hurt, and that's one of the reasons I put him in the lineup today.
Being back in this clubhouse, that bring back some special memories of the playoff run?
Yeah, it has. It has. The last time we walked through here, we were in the World Series, so it definitely brings. I think any time I enter this clubhouse, I think you're gonna reflect back upon that series.
Well, Scotty Posednik said it so well. For the guys who are part of the magical run to the World Series championship, tonight is really special. They get a chance to look around, walk around the clubhouse, talk to some of the fans, and reflect on everything they accomplished last October. Tonight, of course, the World Series championship banner will be raised to the rafters here at U.S. Cellular Field. And then on Tuesday, the players will receive their World Championship rings. It all adds up to a very special opening series against the Cleveland Indians.
The ring's going to be pretty damn cool.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah, that banner's going to be, you know, special for the whole city. But, you know, getting the ring, you know, that means a lot more to, you know, me personally.
What are you going to do
with it? Oh, I'm going to wear it everywhere. No, you know, of course I'm going to wear it maybe a day or two, but it's definitely going to be put away.
The ring's for sure. I mean, that's what you know, when you're a kid and all that, you come across a person every now and again or a coach or even another player that has one. That's what you want to try on. That's what you want to look at. So to get one of your own, that's pretty cool.
Every opening day is real important. I think this year is going to be more special. I think the way people in Chicago acting, the people in Chicago looking for this day, sort of my players, sort of I, sort of my family, I think it's going to be, you know, we're waiting for so many years to get this opening day and get the flag, the championship flags going on. And, you know, it's going to be a lot of nice things. I think this week, this homestand is going to be, you know, something you're never going to forget.
Well, there are a lot of new players on this White Sox roster, including the new DH, Jim Thome, who had so many great years with the Cleveland Indians. We'll talk with Mr. Thome a little bit later in the show. That's going to do it from in front of the Indians dugout. Let's send it back over to the third base side and Chuck Arfine. Chuck?
All right, thank you very much, Mark. And we'll be hearing from Kenny Williams, GM of the White Sox. He'll be coming up to sit down with me in a little bit. But for now, let's send it right back to the studio. Pat and Kerry, wish you were here. It's a lot of fun, very exciting time.
That's right, Chuck. And it's nice that the guys can celebrate in their uniforms in front of their fans for the first time, winning every step of the way in the playoffs last year on the road. including clinching in Detroit. It's nice to finally have that done and kind of put the final footnote on that 2005 season.
And I know Ozzie and the players are excited about it, but I think Ozzie would just as soon get it all over with and get on with the rest of the season as well.
That's right. Burley and the Sox trying to duplicate the 2005 opening day, a two-hit, 1-0 shutout over these same Indians.
It's the first of 19 games against the Tribe, who you might remember lost 14 games to the White Sox last year, including 9 one-run contests. But that hasn't stopped the Indians from their recent trash-talking these days. You can bet the Sox would like to make them eat their words tonight. The first pitch of the new season is just about 55 minutes away at U.S. Cellular Field. Still to come, we'll head back to the South Side, where, as Chuck mentioned, Sox GM Kenny Williams will be live, reflecting on the magical ending to 2005 and giving us his expectations on the upcoming season. It's all next on Sports Night.
The home plate umpire said that ball hit into the ground. Clearly, Josh Ball caught it. And that's into the left field corner. This ball is off the wall. The White Sox have won.
A.J.'s infamous drop third strike play in Game 2 of the ALCS set up one thrilling finish, and the Sox never lost another game in round to winning the title. The World Series trophy has been on a whirlwind tour all winter, and today on display at the Cell for the fans to enjoy. And tonight, the Sox begin their quest to keep that trophy on the South Side. Thanks for joining us for a special hour-long edition of Land Rover Sports Night.
Time now to head back to U.S. Cellular Field and hear from the architect of this World Championship team, a guy who didn't wait long this past offseason to strengthen the ball club for the Encore Championship run. Here's Chuck Garfine live with Sox GM Kenny Williams.
Yeah, Kenny, a lot of stuff was done in the offseason. Did you accomplish everything you wanted? Did you get all the players you wanted to get here in the offseason? What can you tell us?
Well, tough question. Because I don't want to divulge. Let me just put it to you this way. I'm very happy with the team that we're going to put on the field today to start the 06 season. So, you know, we've got a nice little blend of pitching and a balanced, we think we have a balanced offense, but ultimately, you know, the test starts today.
When you win the World Series, I would think that teams would be reluctant to make deals with you. Did you find that to be the case or not?
No, not really. I mean, I've got a great relationship with most of the general managers out there. And really, when you're talking, they're trying to improve their team. So if you have players that that they need and they desire, then, you know, the conversations are going to flow regardless of what you've done in 06, 05. Everybody's trying to win for their own situations. They're not really too concerned. I've never been concerned with giving the New York Yankees, for instance, who have 26 championships. I've never been concerned with giving them a good player. I'm worried about the White Sox.
So the only difference is they just congratulate you.
Yeah, they congratulate you, and you get some good-natured ribbing, you know, when things don't go your way. It's a pretty close fraternity, actually.
Yeah, well, you got Jim Thome. There are the health questions around him. He looks great right now. I'm sure with every home run he hits, you got to feel good about yourself.
Well, I feel good about the team.
Oh, yeah.
Absolutely. I mean, this... people here in Chicago are going to like Jim Thome, not just because he's going to reach the seats, but he's going to get some big hits for us, and he's a quality man, quality guy in the clubhouse, on the bench. He's got a lot of fire in him, and anybody that has any concerns about us being complacent or what have you, because we've now won, Jim Thome isn't going to let that happen.
The last time the White Sox won the World Series, the next year they were 10 games under 500. I don't think you guys are going to be 10 games under 500, but the goal is winning again, repeating. How difficult is that going to be, you think, for these guys?
Well, when people talk about repeating, I think you, those in the media and fans talk about repeating the World Series. I don't think we can be that arrogant to assume that we're going to try to repeat the World Series and ignore the Cleveland Indians and the Minnesota Twins and Detroit Tigers, you know, in our own division. So when we talk about repeating, what we're referring to is the division. We have to, again, respect our talent and know that this is going to be one of the toughest divisions in baseball because it's got some of the best pitching.
You're going to see the banners pretty soon.
Well,
behind us,
the grass, you know, it's opening day. The grass is greener. It's certainly There's more energy and excitement in the air, and I think that just adds to it to be able to see a World Series banner hanging up.
Will the ring mean more to you, or seeing these banners?
You know, well, I can't take the banners with me to dinner at night.
We can see what we can do.
Will.
Maybe there's something we can do about that.
All right. Well, let's see. If you can, if you got a connection, let me know, please.
I don't have any. I'm sorry. I don't know where that came from. Kenny, thank you very much for being
with
us.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
All right. Well, Mitch Robinson, he was tailgating way earlier today when a lot of the other fans came in to tailgate. It's quite a feeling outside the ballpark. That is where Mitch is. Mitch, take it away.
Thanks a lot, Chuck. Much like the postseason last year, I drew the tough assignment once again. Nothing but fine beverages and food out here in the parking lot before the game. And if I were a little thinner, I'd get out of that chair a lot easier. This year's Randy, one of our Sox faithful. Randy, what do we got going today?
Doing a little chicken satay and peanut sauce for an appetizer. And then doing prime rib, garlic mashed potatoes, and glazed carrots for the vegetable, and then doing a little crepes for dessert.
Randy, do a lot to debunk the blue-collar White Sox fan myth.
I just love to tailgate and love to party, so.
Well, don't we all, Randy? Don't we all? Are you sick of the song yet, though?
No, I'm not. I love it. I'm a diehard Sox fan.
I'll come back, and we'll just sit around. We'll listen to a little Journey together, reminisce.
Nice, nice. That work nice. For you? Yeah, perfect.
Okay, cool. Then we'll go inside and party.
Awesome.
Right, Scott, I noticed you're doing the chops. One thing I've noticed about the pre-parting, the ratio of men to women out here for the opener, probably about 20 men to every one woman.
Yeah, it is a little rough out here today.
All right, ladies, I got to tell you, this is about the only tent that actually has women at it.
Hey,
they say opening day is like a guy thing.
No discriminating. No. We're all Sox fans. Woo!
I have noticed, though, that every guy is cooking here. What happened? Is this
we all made something. She made brownies.
Nice.
Wow. I made salad.
Nice.
I'm just here to eat.
She's just here to watch baseball.
We are just here to eat, and then we're kicking Tom out of his chair over there in a little bit. Don't get too comfortable. All right. Pat Carey, we're going to send it back to you. When I get bored of this scene, I'll head inside to the stadium. That'll be about first pitch. Talk to you later.
All right, Mitch, looking forward to that. I think now Mitch's doctor and his wife are watching every one of his fan pieces for different reasons. But
I'd have to guess so. And I think the other thing I was surprised about, is what happened to burgers and brats, prime rib and glazed carrots?
Hey, you win a world championship. The menu, everything moves up. Hey, coming up later on. In this hour-long edition of Land Rover Sports Night, we'll have the unveiling of the White Sox World Series banner on the light stands, plus another live report. We'll hear from the newcomer, Jim Thome, coming up on Sports Night.
Two out. With Canerco on. And he rips one in the left. Canerco, grand slam. Zednik hits one to deep right center field. Back at the wall. The ball is gone. And the White Sox win it 7-6.
Plenty of surprises last fall. Pacetic's two postseason dingers after going homerless during the regular season would fall into that category. Sox fans had a bit of a scare during spring training with Pods with a groin injury, but Scott says he's 100% and he will be in that starting lineup tonight.
Great to hear, and Ozzie Guinness said Podsednik will get more rest in the first half to hopefully keep him healthy all season. Speaking of getting healthy, that's exactly what the newest member of the Sox lineup did this spring. Jim Thome's elbow problems seem to be behind him, and if the last week or so of spring training is any indication, those fireworks at the Cell should get quite a workout this season. We now join Mark Schanowski live for more on Thome's big Southside debut, and Mark, I can imagine quite a number of fans made the trek up from Peoria for Thome's big day.
Jim Thome did mention the fact that he will have a lot of family and friends cheering him on. And if you're wondering how popular this new slugger is going to be wearing the White Sox pinstripes, well, he just taped a public service announcement about 5 minutes ago. They played it on the big screen. He got a big ovation just for the pre-recorded announcement. I think number 25 is going to be a big hit. You know, for the late part of the 90s, first part of this decade, Jim Thome was the face of Cleveland Indians baseball. He had so many big games against the White Sox. Then he went over the National League, played 3 years for the Phillies. Well, now in the irony that is professional sports, Jim Thome is back in the American League and is taking his cuts against the Tribe as a member of the world champion White Sox. As Kerry mentioned, there were some concerns that maybe Jim Thome's best years were behind him. He had that serious elbow injury that caused him to miss about half of the 2005 season. But Thome, being a veteran, well, he went back to Peoria, he rehabbed like a madman, and he finished Cactus League play very strong. He was hitting home runs all over the place, about a half dozen in the last week alone. Jim Thome took some time after taking his cuts in the cage, talked about joining the world champion White Sox.
It'll be exciting. It'll be exciting. My family's here tonight from Peoria, and, you know, it'll just, I think it's going to be a great year all the way around.
Jim, you're a veteran player, but I'm sure just about any major leaguer has butterflies on opening day.
Always. Well, opening day is unlike any other game because it's the first game of the year, and it kicks off, especially the first game of the year. So, you know, I've always have had butterflies, and, you know, I think you should cherish every moment of it because you don't know how long it's going to last, and, you know, and when it does, you got to really soak it all in.
And one of the sidelights to watch tonight, Jim Thome taking his cuts against C.C. Sabathia. Sabathia's about a 6'7 hard-throwing left-hander. It'll be interesting to see if he dusts his old teammates since Tomey's scrambling to the ground. But Tomey's not the only new White Sox player on the 25-man roster today. We've got Rob Mikoviak, the Oak Lawn native. Alex Cintron, a switch-hitting middle infielder. Javier Vazquez, a former All-Star pitcher with the Yankees. And don't forget a guy who could be a dark horse guy, a key player on this team. That's left-handed reliever Matt Thornton. They acquired him late in spring training in a trade with Seattle for Joe Borchard. And Thornton could be a key. He could be a potential setup man for Bobby Jenks late in the ballgame. Had a chance to talk to Thornton just before the game.
Need to prove myself to these guys. You know, they know who I am. I've pitched against them quite a few times, but you know, once again, you have to prove that I can pitch in big innings, big times, and have Ozzie have the confidence in me to be out there at the right times.
How about all the hoopla? Opening day is always special, but when a team comes off a World Series, you can tell by all the media in here, it's kind of crazy.
Yeah, I was gonna go get a snack a minute ago, and then I looked at the media that was in the clubhouse on the run there, and I just sat back down. I was waiting until after batting practice is done.
Well, the last thing we want to do is prevent a ball player from getting that snack he needs before the game. You got to keep your energy level up. But Matt Thornton and 21-year-old Boone Logan will be left-handers in the bullpen. And these guys could be important as they try to fill the role that was done by Damaso Marte a year ago. Dustin Hermanson right now is back in Arizona rehabbing his back injury. He's going to join the team on Tuesday for the ring ceremony. But they're going to need some young guys to take his spot in terms of being a setup guy for Bobby Jenks. That's going to do it from here. Let's go over to Chuck and our man Bill Melton by the White Sox dugout. Guys?
Thank you very much, Mark. Good to see you, Bill.
Well, you know, Chuck, it's been a short 4 months, haven't it? I'm used to having 5 months, but only 4 months this year.
I think we'll take it. You know, Mark was talking about some of the new guys. How about an old guy? Well, he's not old, but he's been here a while. Mark Burley, his fifth consecutive start, opening day start for the White Sox. He's been everything they've wanted.
Well, you know what? He's a model of consistency, Chuck, and I think that's really important. Number one, he's a very good teammate. Number two, Mark Burley will take the mound anywhere from 32 to 34 times a year. What better guy to open up the season each and every year? And the White Sox, you know, they honor him with it. That's quite an honor for a pitcher. I think the record's something like 7.
And if there's a question about the weather, if there's going to be rain, hey, at least you got Burley out there. We can get in and out of here pretty quickly. That might help out. Scott Pesennik, we've talked about it on this show. He is going to play. But the thing that bugs the White Sox maybe a little bit is the fact that he's still, you know, they haven't even started the season. There's already something with the groin. Hopefully it's nothing, but it might turn out to be something.
Well, you know what? When a guy makes his living with his legs and you have these kind of problems, it is kind of worrisome because if we remember last year when Scott Pesennik was in the lineup, the White Sox were a whole different ball club. Now with Rob Mikoviak, of course, and Cintron that we got from the Diamondbacks, this is going to make it a little bit easier if Scott Pesennik feels any kind of tightness in his legs. But I'd like to see him play 150 games, 145, 150 games. He means too much to the top of the lineup. It makes Tad Aguchi even a better number two hitter. And, of course, with Jim Thome, Paul Konerko, and Jermaine Dye, I think the White Sox are going to score a lot more runs.
You see a lot more runs. Will there be, a lot more wins? They won 99 games last year. Could this team be a better team than last year, is it?
You know what? I think it's a better team on paper, but it's really tough to win 100 games like the Yankees did about 5 or 6 years ago. But I think this ball club's capable of being in the middle 90s. I want to say 92, 93 wins. And the reason I think that's enough to win the Central is the fact that the Central is a much better Central division than it ever has been. So the White Sox play each one of those guys 19 times. They're not going to be able to bottom feed off of guys like Kansas City or Detroit anymore. They're better ball clubs. Of course, you got the Cleveland Indians, a much improved ball club. I don't think there's as good this year so far. I haven't seen much, obviously not even a first pitch,
right,
as they were last year, but I still think I like the chances of the White Sox for a long season.
And one difference for the White Sox, a big difference, is they are now World Series champs. Yeah. That's good and it's bad. They've got a target on their backs. They're going to come into every game, onto every field, and that opposition is going to want to beat the snot out of them.
You know, I don't really think it changes the approach of the White Sox. I really don't. I'm not speaking from any kind of experience. I'm not speaking because I haven't heard these guys talk enough about it. I think they have the attitude. They're just going to go out there and try to win each and every ball game. And I think if they do that, and Ozzie won't let them go off on a track thinking they're too good, if they can just do that, concentrate with that five-man rotation, wear people down, I think the White Sox will prevail in the Central.
All right, well, it's a pretty warm night. It's warmer than we thought it would be. The coldest opening day game, 1974. This guy was batting cleanup in it. 37 degrees. You remember that one?
I was making angels in snow out in the suburbs. I remember that.
All right, well, that was 74. That's not going to be 74 here tonight, but it is warm and no rain as of yet. That's good news. We'll send it back to the studio with Pat and Kerry.
All right, Chuck, and Wilbur Wood was on the bump for the Southsiders on that day. He had the longest current stretch at that time of consecutive starts on opening day from 72 to 76. Mark Burley now trumps him with his fifth consecutive start tonight.
And opening day is such a tough time for pitchers, but Burley's done quite well, 2-1 with a 1.63 earning over that stretch of four starts, so let's hope he's got another win. That he'll get another win under his belt tonight. We, folks, are just over 30 minutes away from the Sox and Indians playing ball on the south side. Still to come, we'll head back to the corner of 35th and Shields and check in with the fans who are still basking in the glow of that World Series title and gearing up for yet another exciting season.
Check in! Yeah. And the White Sox are the champions of the 2005 Central Division. Yes!
Welcome back to U.S. Cellular Field. Josh Kelly getting the White Sox crowd warmed up here. Opening night, White Sox and Indians just a few moments away, as well as the banner. It's not really a banner raising, it's a banner unveiling. We'll be doing that just in a few minutes right here on Comcast Sportsnet, so you want to definitely stay tuned for that. And welcome back to the show. Chuck Arfine here, sitting down and getting ready for what should be a great, great night ahead. And if you think about it, the last White Sox game was game two of the World Series, and Scott Pitsenik hit that game-winning home run to take a 2-0 series lead over the Astros. Hopefully there is more fireworks later tonight. Mitch Robinson, he's in the crowd, he's in the park. He's got something to say. Hey, Mitch.
All right, Chuck, out here in the stands, getting ready to start this game. Is that all you guys got?
The World Series, what's it like to get it for opening night?
It's beautiful. It's a fantastic experience. I've been a huge fan for a long, long time. Very happy to have a winning
World
team
champion.
Back in Chicago. It's a beautiful
Woo!
Thing. World champions, baby! Woo!
Number one! And the best thing about him is he has the South Side accent down. Let me ask you something. Were one of you guys, were any of you guys at the World Series game?
Yeah!
So what's it mean to get back here tonight now? Awesome. You think you might have to take off from school tomorrow to go to Boston?
Yeah.
Yeah, you think your dad will cover?
Yeah.
Yeah? All right, so we're getting ready to throw the first pitch. My goal is...
Take it off Wednesday.
They're here for the whole series. My goal is, who's got an extra ticket for me?
See how silent it got? No one has a ticket for me. Pat Carey, I'm going to find a seat, find some way to worm my way into this, just like I did game two.
Back to you. Let's whoop it out.
Yeah!
Fans already fired up for this big one. Mitch, I'm sure, will find a way to worm his way in.
He's encouraging kids to skip school tomorrow. Come on, Mitch.
All right, well, we are going to give you the moment you've all been waiting for. It's the ceremony coming up next, live right here on this very network.
Still needing that hit. Burke pops it up. Left side. Will it stay in play? The catch is made by Uribe, an unbelievable grab. Palmeiro over the head of Jenks. Uribe charges, throws, out! And the White Sox have won the World Series.
So many great moments from the White Sox. First World Series title in 88 years. Welcome back to the special hour-long edition of Land Rover Sports Night. We are getting you ready for that live ceremony out on the South Side.
And for one White Sox fan, this night has a special meaning to him as he has a very special honor. It was certainly tough to get a ticket to tonight's season opener, but nothing compared to trying to score tickets to last year's World Series games on the South Side. For one devoted White Sox fan, he had ducats to the Fall Classic, but his unselfish act helped a far greater cause. It's an act of kindness that has not gone unnoticed by the White Sox organization. William Jackson has the story of Ryan Devlin.
Ryan Devlin from Tinley Park, you have a very unique story. The White Sox picked up his tab this year for season tickets all year long, but it's how we got to that point that is so unique. Explain your story if you could.
Yes, sir. I was about 6 weeks after Hurricane Katrina hit. I was sitting at home and decided that I needed to do a little something more than just give money. So I started a relief drive, collected just a boatload of goods to take down there, and then realized I didn't really have the cash to run a truck or anything. And needed to fulfill my promise to all the folks that contributed. And the next day, the White Sox won the American League Championship. I realized that if I sold my tickets to the World Series, I'd be able to get down there.
Now let me. You're a true White Sox fan.
Yes, sir.
33 years of age.
Yes, sir. 34.
34. So 34 years, once in a lifetime opportunity, and you said this is what I've been waiting on. But you decided to sacrifice.
Yeah, definitely. You know, it's just, I mean, you see all the tragedy and stuff that goes on down there. It's just, it just rips at your heart that, you just really, I felt the need to just do more, you know. And it's just been a great experience. I do it again in a heartbeat.
So you sold the tickets for a nice penny and it was enough to finance your trip down?
Yes, sir. And, it's funny. I said to my dad was actually at the 59 World Series with his dad. And I had said to him, I said there'll be other opportunities like this. Wow. And he said, I said that back in 59 too.
Right. And we see how long we waited.
Exactly.
Right?
We waited a while. So
some $2,500 you were able to garner from that to take care of that. And you took care of the people. And could you ask for a better situation? They talk about karma and how it comes back. And it's come back to you, I understand, on Oprah's show. A couple of the players came, and they were very appreciative of what you did.
Yeah, Mark Burley, Scott Pesednik showed up on the show, unbeknownst to me. And, they paid for my tickets, like you said. But they also, shipped me out to spring training for a couple of days. I took my dad out there. And they're sending me the All-Star game in July. And the Sox are just a class act organization. They treated me so well. And it's just been a fantastic experience to deal with them.
Okay, and tonight, big night. Just tell us, you're throwing out ceremonial first pitch. Dream come true?
Yeah, dream come true. And I look around out here, and I wasn't nervous at all until about 5 minutes ago, it's a little hard. The one thing I do want to say, though, is, there's still some just horrific things going on down in the Gulf Coast, and every opportunity I get, I want to make sure that I remind people that there's so much that needs to be done down there still. And, I always say that if every person within earshot of this would just, pick up one family or one person in the Gulf and take them under their wings, we will solve this problem far faster than any government response ever would. So,
Ryan, appreciate your contribution.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate it.
All right.
Thanks.
Let's go back to you.
Our thanks to William, who, as you saw, was able to catch up with Ryan Devlin, and certainly his generosity has come back to him tenfold, and certainly an exciting opportunity for him to get to throw out the first pitch on what is the biggest opening day for the Sox in many years. Now, we are nearing the first pitch between the Sox and Indians on the South Side. As Burley will go up against CeCe Sabathia, it's a rematch of opening day a year ago. The championship ceremony is going on tonight and later this week are really more for the fans than the players themselves.
At least that's what Ozzie Guillen hopes. Since day one of spring training, he said last year's last year and that his team now wears a bullseye on their uniform. Still, the guys can't help but be excited about tonight's opener.
You're excited for opening day. I think it's a divisional game, and there's something added to that for sure, because you don't want to get every one of those games counts in the division. That's where you win and lose the division against the teams in the division. But you can't really add much more. I mean, opening day is huge, and it's a big deal. No matter if you're opening in Seattle or Tampa, it's always a big deal, and you just can't add all that other stuff in. There's only so much you can get up for.
Let's head to White Sox PA announcer Gene Honda for tonight's introductions of the visitors from Cleveland.
batting sixth and playing first base, number 33, Eduardo Perez. Batting seventh, the second baseman, number 20, Ronnie Belliard. Batting eighth, the third baseman, number 17, Aaron Boone. Batting ninth and playing right field, number 1, Casey Blake. And pitching for Cleveland and warming up in right field, number 52, C.C. Sabathia. And the rest of the Cleveland Indians, their staff and trainers.
This is live coverage of the Sox
and now,
opening
and
night pregame festivities honoring the 2005 World Champion White Sox live on Comcast Sportsnet. Here's Gene Honda with the introduction of the 2006 White Sox.
Assistant trainer Brian Ball. Director of conditioning Alan Thomas. Home clubhouse manager Vince Fresso. Home clubhouse assistant manager Rob Warren. Visiting clubhouse manager Gabe Morrell. Visiting clubhouse assistant manager and umpire clubhouse manager Joe McNamara Jr. Head groundskeeper Roger Bossard. Bench coach number 30, Tim Raines. First base coach number 3, Harold Baines. Third base coach number 28, Joey Cora. Hitting coach number 29, Greg Walker. Pitching coach number 21, Don Cooper. Bullpen coach number 53, Art Kushner. Bullpen catcher number 59, Mansu Lee. And introducing your 2006 Chicago White Sox. Number 8, Alex Cintron. Number 10, Rob Mikowiak. Number 17, Ross Glode. Number 18, Cliff Polite. Number 20, John Garland. Number 33, Javier Vasquez. Number 34, Freddie Garcia. Number 36, Chris Widger. Number 37, Matt Thornton. Number 38, Pablo Osuna. Number 45, Bobby Jenks. Number 46, Neil Kotz. Number 55, Brandon McCarthy. And number 57, Boone Logan. And now the starting lineup for tonight's game, beginning with White Sox manager number 13, Ozzie Guillen. leading off for the White Sox and playing left field, number 22, Scott Pusednik. Batting second, the second baseman, number 15, Hanahito Iguchi. Batting third, the designated hitter, number 25, Jim Thome. Batting fourth, the first baseman, number 14, Paul Konerko. Batting fifth and playing right field, number 23, Jermaine Dye. Batting sixth in the bullpen, the catcher, number 12, A.J. Pierzynski. Batting seventh, the third baseman, number 24, Joe Creedy. Batting eighth, the shortstop, number 5, Juan Uribe. Batting ninth in play center field, number 44, Brian Anderson. And pitching for the White Sox, number 56, Mark Burley.
Crowd is jumping at U.S. Cellular Field. Everyone ready to get things started between the Sox and Indians. We are currently awaiting the national anthem, which will be performed by Josh Kelly. In the meantime, we will take you right through the remainder of the coverage at U.S. Cellular Field. You can see the fans starting to remove their caps.
You know, after going 11-1 in the playoffs last year and matching the 99 Yankees, the Sox said the most difficult part of the championship run was knocking off the team they're playing tonight, the Indians. A little irony that they'll begin their trek at repeating against that same team tonight. We will have game two of the White Sox season Tuesday as the Sox and Indians go at it at 1 o'clock. Our pregame coverage begins at 12 noon. This, again, is your home for the White Sox in 2006. We bring you 99 regular season games right here on Comcast Sportsnet.
And you know, Pat, we heard Chuck and Bill Melton talking earlier about the Indians. You've got a lot of experts picking the Indians over the White Sox to win the division this upcoming season. I have a feeling it's going to be quite a battle between these two teams this year. And we've already heard the Indians starting their trash talk about how they don't think the White Sox got that much better and doesn't see that they're that much better than this year. And now you can see they're getting ready. Hollywood Records recording artist Josh Kelly will perform tonight's national anthem. Let's send you back to the field.
Oh, say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, all the ramparts we watched were so gallantly and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say, does that star-spangled banner yet
perfect timing there at U.S. Cellular as the F-18 Hornets from the U.S. Navy make their way after Josh Kelly sings the national anthem. We're moments away from the unveiling of the divisional, the ALCS, and the World Series banners It'll be on the flagstaffs out in left center, right center, and right field. A magical night. It's nice, again, that the folks that follow this team get an opportunity to enjoy this with the team in the building. All of the championships last year and winning the division and whatnot was done on the road. So this is a special night, certainly on the South Side.
And a special night for the fans, a special night for all the players who were part of that championship team last year. And also, some of the newcomers like Rob Mikowiak and Jim Thome, Matt Thornton, guys who weren't part of that but get to experience this and get a taste of what potentially this season could be like.
They're going to look back right now at last season, the 2005 campaign in the World Series, as they take a look at a video tribute on the Jumbotron at U.S. Cellular.
The call. Peter Gammons and Sam Ryan contributing from the field. Enjoy the game, folks.
The following is an exclusive presentation of ESPN2, the worldwide leader in sports.
Mm-hmm.
It is baseball's opening night in Chicago, and the weather forecast is for some bad weather, but right now, nothing can rain on the parade here as the Major League champion White Sox begin the defense of their title, and White Sox fans from all over Chicago have made their way to the South Side as tonight the White Sox open up against their arch rivals, the Cleveland Indians, who have visions of supplanting them at the top of the Central Division this year. Just moments ago, the championship banner unveiled.
Oh, Chicago, for all you've seen since last we met.
Couldn't have it to a bed.
Difference 88 years can make when real hope finally settles over the South Side, when a reason to believe finally blows into the Windy City, when age-old prayers are about to be answered. It is so much sweeter for how long it had been, so much sweeter for all the pain.
I know the fans was hungry about bring a championship.
Well, 88 years, but I understand a lot of Sox fans have been waiting that long. It's a rough time.
To be able to bring home a championship, not only for White Sox fans, but just the city itself, it was a great feeling.
This season was real special for everyone in Chicago.
It was an opportunity to make the years disappear, and they took it. Quickly turn to memories, and memories to wanting more.
For the city, it brought a lot of smiles and a lot of tears to a lot of faces.
No matter what happens from here on out, we'll always have that in our pocket.
I can't wait to just come back here and be with my players.
I can't wait to see everybody, and I can't wait to play baseball.
I can't wait to get the ring, and I can't wait to see how crazy the city of Chicago is.
2005 is over, and I remind the people, we was the world champion. We're not the world champion anymore.
Oh, Chicago. Another season, another shot, and we can't wait.
Cellular Field, and the ovation was big, as if it had happened all over again, as they showed a film recounting some of the great moments of last year, and there were many tears in this ballpark tonight. White Sox fans celebrating all over again. It's opening night in Major League Baseball, presented by ESPN2, built by the Home Depot. And the Cleveland Indians, they were dramatically disappointed that they were not in the postseason last year. They fell short at the end. Tonight, they begin their shot as they take on the champions, the White Sox. Hello, everyone. I'm John Miller with Joe Morgan, and welcome back to our 17th season of Major League Baseball on ESPN and ESPN2. I'm John Miller with Joe Morgan. And, Joe, congratulations. Another Emmy nomination for you and another season of baseball. Are you up to it?
I'm up to it. I'm ready for it.
Because you're getting up there now. You're not getting any
younger. I'm ready for it.
All right. Also, Sam Ryan and Peter Gammons will be with us here tonight. And most of those White Sox who provided so many thrills last October are also back. But the general manager, Kenny Williams, he did not stand pat. He went out and made a couple of dramatic moves, none more dramatic than bringing in the former Cleveland great slugger, Jim Thome, and they're hoping Chomey will hit a lot of home runs here in the south side of Chicago this year.
Well, John, I think that was a great addition to this ball club. If you look back over the last part of last season, the reason they got to the World Series was Paul Konerko, and he was the reason they won. They need to give Paul Konerko and Jermaine Dye some help, and I think Jim Thome's the right guy to do that. First of all, Jim Thome's the kind of slugger that can carry you by himself for a week at a time, like Konerko and Dye did last year. And I watched him this year down on the batting practice. He was swinging the bat just great. And when I looked at him, he looked like a young Jim Thome. So thin, I couldn't believe it was Jim Thome. So I think they made the right choice of bringing Thome in, a right-handed bat, a left-handed bat to go with the two right-handed sluggers.
Cleveland's all-time home run leader now trying to help the White Sox beat Cleveland. And talk about that Cleveland ball club. They've got great young talent, some of the best young talent in the game, like Grady Sizemore in center field, Johnny Peralta at short, Travis Hafner, the slugger, the DH, Victor Martinez, the outstanding catcher, and the extraordinary left-hander who makes the start for them tonight, young, extraordinary, hard-throwing CC Sabathia.
Well, John, we always talk about the potential of CC Sabathia because he's the guy that's going to one of these days win 20 ball games. I think this might be the year. When you talk to him, he's matured a lot. I think he's also going to assume the role that Kevin Millwood had here last year, the leader of the staff. And if they're going to win in the Central Division, they're going to need CC Sabathia to be the leader of this staff. And I think he's ready to do it. And I actually think that this will be the year that he'll win 20 ball games.
All right. And did I mention he's extraordinary? All right. The White Sox right now, they're the champions of Major League Baseball. But it's a new season. As Ozzie Guillen, their manager, has said, hey, that was last year. So here we go. A new season of Major League Baseball. The White Sox, the reigning champions. The banner has been unfurled. They are the Major League Baseball champions. And tonight, their starting pitcher, the veteran left-hander, Mark Burley, his fifth consecutive opening day assignment. Burley is just about ready to go. And the first pitch of this one, Burley and Grady Sizemore, coming up when we return.